Welcome back, and welcome to our first panel session of the day. We have a wonderful group of experts who came together to tell us about citizen potential in Bosnia and Herzegovina. This conversation will be moderated by Aleksandra Tomanić, who is the Executive Director of the European Fund for the Balkans. Aleksandra, take it away.
Thank you very much. Hello, good afternoon. Yes, our panel today has dynamism and really different perspectives and this real life dimension. We will hear really inspiring examples that did make a change and that did contribute to last impact. Yesterday we heard a lot about state capture, and even the EU speaks about it in their documents, but somehow on a more abstract level, as if some secret forces are capturing the state, and then they just continue as if nothing happened and meet and have family pictures with those that have captured it. Sabina Tudic said yesterday, and I quote now, "The policies of your countries failed miserably," and she was addressing the international community and its main actors. The EU enlargement process is in deep crisis since a while now, and now really this crisis is affecting each single country of the region. When we speak about Bosnia, it never really delivered. A lot of trust is lost. Trust into the international community, trust into the state, trust in its institutions, trust into political parties, trust even into organized civil society. But there is hope. Hope that built this trust so desperately needed. And that hope is provided by the citizens themselves. I know it's a number of big words, trust, hope, citizens. Citizens, a category not really recognized nor valued in the annex of the Dayton Peace Agreement, a fact that led to cementing the fragmentation and division, even 25 years later. Focus and priority was not given to constituents in their function as citizens, but to their belonging to constituent people. Today's panel is therefore adequately named Despite Politics, Citizen Potential in Bosnia and Herzegovina. And there is potential. Today, we will just hear a little extract of it. And I will introduce the panelists in their appearance of speaking, and I would like to start with Jasmin, who is a political scientist and researcher and co-host of the popular Sarajevo Calling podcast. He's researching post-conflict peace studies, and he's written a book that came out in 2018, Hunger and Fury, The Crisis of Democracy in the Balkans, where he actually argues that the Balkans are on the brink of this historic socio-political transformation. So, Jasmin, welcome very much. And please do introduce us. What did you mean with this historic transformation we are just about to experience? And maybe we can start with what happened in Bosnia in 2014. How did it happen? Why did it stop? What did it change, and where are we today? I know a lot of questions, but I would still like to ask you to stick to the 5 minutes we have agreed, and then we can continue and deepen it later. Thank you and welcome.
Thank you, and thank you to all of the organizers, especially my colleague Maite Ruge, as well as all these distinguished panelists who I'm very honored to share the stage with. I think 2014, the protests in Bosnia-Herzegovina in 2014, to my mind, are probably the most significant and overt political act in the country since the end of the war. We have a lot of day-to-day politics, of course, in Bosnia, but 2014, along with the so-called baby revolution in 2013, was the first large-scale manifestation of public displeasure and protest against the ruling nationalist oligarchy in Bosnia-Herzegovina. And I think what was also very significant about 2014 was that it was so dangerous. It had a real edge to it. It was a moment of contestation. It was a moment of genuine crisis. And it was a moment that I think articulated the kind of, I mean, you know, at the risk of saying something that I think people sometimes misunderstand slightly, I think it articulated the emotional landscape of Bosnia-Herzegovina as a country dealing with very large-scale mental health issues, PTSD. It was in some ways a manifestation of this. Those of you who know about post-traumatic stress disorder and the long-lasting generational consequences that can leave, you know that it can manifest itself in different ways, sometimes as rage, sometimes as anger, which is what we saw in 2014, but it can also manifest itself as, and it, in fact, it is itself a form of incredible perseverance and psychological survival. And in the immediate aftermath of those protests, we saw these incredible so-called plenumi, where you had these large-scale experiments in direct democracy. Now, there's been a lot of criticisms of the plenums because they were, you know, insufficient, insufficiently capable of delivering sustained political change, et cetera, et cetera. And I myself have written about some of these critiques, including in the book. But I think as we have to also step back a little bit and understand them as the first time in post-war Bosnian history that ordinary Bosnians, Herzegovinians, had the opportunity to express and manifest their own grievances. And I mean, the last thing that I'll say is that, you know, I was part of a collective of people who were not in Bosnia at the time, and we actually translated all of the demands that were coming out of the plenumi in Zenica, in Sarajevo, in Tuzla, Mostar, etc., because we wanted to preserve the track record. We wanted to preserve the written demands that these plenums were creating. And when you go back and look at them, they are incredibly mature, they are incredibly genuine, and they are offering us a vision of a kind of comprehensive transformation of Bosnia that obviously we have yet to enact. But I do think in many ways, the blueprint for popular legitimacy and change is there.
Okay, but it was really a blast of hope, not only in mm-hmm. and for Bosnia, but for the whole region. Sure. Can you maybe bring us closer? What happened? Why did it stop? And why it was not translated into something more sustainable?
So one very obvious answer is that, for those of you who remember your timeline, is that there was these historic devastating floods that happened in the immediate aftermath of the protests. And that really, really cut the legs out underneath from a lot of the mobilization and organizing. That was one thing. The other thing was that the wholesale architecture of the nationalist oligarchy in Bosnia immediately began coordinating very, very closely together and spending tens of millions of euros procuring anti-riot gear and various other kinds of crowd control mechanisms. And there was very, very aggressive policing that was taking place all across the country, including in places like Banja Luka, which did not see large-scale protests, but there was a lot of threats and intimidation that the local police were doing against activists who were attempting to organize similar things on the ground. That was the other reason. And then finally, the biggest reason, of course, and this is something that we've heard a lot of over the last few days, is that the Dayton electoral and constitutional architecture as such is that it actually does not allow for non-nationalist actors to very easily either organize or to translate these victories even into electoral successes. You know, we heard from people from Naša Stranka, probably the most prominent non-nationalist party in the country. There's, of course, many others, smallers and their coalition partners that have tried to do things over the years. Dayton is designed to undermine civic-oriented, citizen-oriented, liberal democratic parties. It is mathematically and structurally extremely difficult to translate those changes. And so what you end up with is that it was unreasonable to expect that for the first time in Bosnian history that you had essentially this kind of mass public insurrection, that it would immediately translate into a long-lasting change. For me, it was a kind of first trial run of something that obviously needs much, much more refining over many years to come.
So the important conclusion is the energy is there, it has showed itself, and it's waiting for the next appearance, so to say.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes.
We will continue with Ivana Korajlić, who is the executive director of Transparency International in Bosnia. Having 12 years of experience dealing with party financing, transparency, preventing corruption, and has really a deep and thorough knowledge of all what is going on and happening. And despite that knowledge, she is still there. She's still fighting for rule of law and transparency, and that in a very enthusiastic manner. And Jasmin just mentioned Banja Luka. We will also come to speak about what happened in the last year in Banja Luka. But I would first really like to invite you to bring us the results and the outreach of your work a little bit closer. And also, where do you draw your energy to continue and to stay and to fight for it on a daily basis?
Well, thank you. Transparency International in Bosnia and Herzegovina is actually celebrating its 20th anniversary these days. And this has been really a good occasion to see where we are and what we have achieved so far, and whether we had any real impact when it comes to the level of corruption in Bosnia and Herzegovina, and when it comes to citizens' awareness on the issues of corruption, on the issues of rule of law. And when we look at the situation that we have now in the country, when it comes to the level of corruption, which is rising, when it comes to the failure of the country to address the issue of corruption in any meaningful way, the fact that we are deteriorating when you look at the data of any a serious research that has been done in the past couple of years, Bosnia and Herzegovina is deteriorating in all aspects. When it comes to the level of democracy, when it comes to its efficiency to fight against corruption, when it comes to integrity of its institutions, we are now in the worst position, I think, in the past 15 years. And if we look at it like that, we would say, then why are we here? I mean, why are we still even fighting against corruption in Bosnia and Herzegovina? And what's the point of civil society organizations who are still trying to do this? But I have to say that, of course, I mean, if it wasn't for the organizations who are providing assistance to citizens, who are pointing out to all that's been going on in the country, to the serious cases of corruption, to the capture of institutions on all of the levels, then I think that we would be even in a worse situation than we are now. So this is, I mean, one of the comforts of this job, but also you do need to find motivation in small wins. When you establish cooperation with some institution who is really trying to improve its procedures or trying to improve its transparency or change at least some of the processes, despite all the political pressures and despite the fact that you have political parties controlling basically every aspect of life in this country, every institution, and even those that are supposed to be independent. But there are those agents of change always that can be found somewhere. So this is where basically you can always find your motivation in, and of course, indirectly helping citizens. We have been doing this since 2003 by providing direct legal assistance to citizens, receiving reports of citizens, acting on their behalf towards the institution. So they do need someone that will support them and that will have the expertise to do something. But as I say, I mean, it is becoming harder to fight this fight, especially when you look at that the elites are becoming stronger, that their networks are becoming and are capturing everything and are not allowing for any significant change to happen. But we have to also be aware that we need always at least 6 to 10 years to spend on an initiative, on a process, in order for it to have any kind of impact. And this is also something maybe to say about the relationship between these institutions and the civil society in general, that any kind of initiative that is coming from the side, from citizens, from civil society, is not taken seriously, even though it is in line with all the, let's say, international standards and everything that has been said by the relevant international institutions. But they are, of course, more interested in remaining the status quo, in remaining their power over all of the institutions, and will not give up these benefits easily. And this is something that we need to take into account in designing any kind of approach on behalf of civil society, or the pressure that we want to see coming from the citizens and not just the international community. We were just having an event last week in the occasion of International Anti-Corruption Day, where we basically concluded that the international community is the only one here that we expect to have real impact on the decision makers in the country. And this is very disappointing. I mean, and this is maybe the answer to the question of the level of citizens' potential here. We always look at the international community that they will come and put pressure and, you know, through financial conditioning or political pressure or anything else, that they are the only ones that can actually persuade the decision makers to change something, and not the citizens and not us. Because we've seen so many times that this pressure didn't work. And Jasmin mentioned the protest in 2014. I think that the disappointed that came after that basically contributed to deteriorating of the citizens' rights generally, and their activism after in the following years. Because after the disappointment, after you spent so much time and effort into an initiative, and this is the same with 2014 and Pravda za Davida later, after you fail and all this doesn't have any kind of real impact, any kind of long-term impact, then people become even more disappointed. And then after that, we saw so many people leave the country, basically giving up on any kind of effort in fighting for their rights or anything else. And I think that the elites are actually counting on this, and that's why they're trying to suppress any kind of real citizen initiative. I'm sorry if this took too long, but there's too many issues to cover when we talk about this.
There are a lot of topics, and you mentioned the importance of civil society in actually fighting for certain values, but still a lot of citizens do not recognize civil society as this kind of actor, and even have lost trust in organized civil society. So this kind of civil society organizations do not manage to mobilize citizens' potentials. Could you a couple of sentences.
I didn't actually hear the last part, but I can guess what the question was. Yes, you're right. I mean, there is this decreasing trust of citizens into professional civil society organizations, let's say so, because there has a lot of funds have been invested into civil society on behalf of international donors in the past 20 years. At the same time, citizens are not sure that they see the effects of these projects and these initiatives. But at the same time, you do need to have some kind of structure, infrastructure and expertise if you want to deal with really complex issues such as institutional and legal reform, for example, in the area of rule of law or fight against corruption. So we need to have in mind that we do need a variety of forms of civil society. Civil society is not only NGOs, it is also informal citizens groups. It is media as well. I don't know, we often leave them out of the picture, but we do need to have this kind of different specter of citizens organizing in order to achieve this pressure from different sides. And I think that this is the key in cooperation between maybe, let's say, standard and traditional or professionalized civil society organizations with informal citizens group who have this energy in the field, who can take on different initiatives in their local communities, but to have someone that will support them both financially, but also through, you know, expertise and legal assistance and other ways of assistance. And I think that this is the issue, and that we haven't, as a civil society in Bosnia and Herzegovina, recognize the potential of this type of cooperation enough.
Thank you very much. This is already a very good introduction to our next speaker, that is Samir Beharić, who is an award-winning youth activist, somebody who moves and motivates others on the ground, and whose activism is surprisingly not only visible, but also recognized internationally, for example, by the OSCE, which honored him with the Max van der Stoel Award. Samir, you are empowering others. You have these great results from your hometown. You are even working in an association that works with people that would like to come back or are coming back. So the other way of migration, which we haven't even touched, and maybe there will be time later. Please tell us, how did you manage not only to address, but to successfully fight school segregation in Jajce?
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, first of all, for organizing this event, inviting me to speak with this excellent group of people in this panel. When it comes to two schools under one roof, when it comes to segregated education in Bosnia and Herzegovina, first of all, maybe for those who do not know what two schools under one roof actually are, two schools under one roof are one of rare ethnic segregation examples in current, today's 21st century Europe. These are the schools where young people, students, pupils from 6 years, 6 years old until they are 18, attend same school buildings, but in different classrooms, meaning depending if they are Croats or Bosniaks, or if they are Muslims slash Catholics. In one of those schools, I have attended one of those schools in the city of Jajce. In the city of Jajce in central Bosnia, we do have segregated primary schools. However, secondary schools are integrated. So our politicians in central Bosnian canton came to a genius idea. They say, okay, well, look, we really have really good job, great, excellent products, young nationalists coming out of primary schools, why wouldn't we segregate also the secondary schools, you know? So they did that, or they tried to do it in 2016. So what they tried to do is, there was a fake petition of parents from the city of Jajce who asked the cantonal ministry to segregate the school, secondary schools in Jajce. And do you know what that means? This means, now imagine attending a secondary school with someone for 4 years. You know, you have your best friends there, you have maybe your boyfriend or girlfriend attending the school, you know, and suddenly someone comes and tells you, okay, from next year, you will be attending the same school building, but on a different floor, in a different classroom. There will be a wall, a physical barrier between you. What they didn't tell them is that we will be building walls, barriers within your heads. And those are the hardest and the biggest walls to topple. So, but the student said, no, we will not allow you to do that. And for the first time in post-war Bosnian history, we had a successful student uprising of young people, minors. Those are people who were like 14, 15, 16, who said, no, we will not allow you to segregate us. So they went to the streets. They went to the streets and they were protesting for straight 1 year. They were asking, demanding from their teachers, from their politicians, local politicians, not to allow segregation. In one moment, you know, the media caught the attention, like the international community caught the attention of students. And in that moment, we had something that we have never had in post-war Bosnian history. We had Bosnian politicians, nationalists, it's important to say here, both from Bosniak and Croat nationalistic camp. So both SDA and HDZ were united in division. They were together voting for segregation of schools. Why? Because more segregation brings them more voters. You know, when you have like an 18-year-old who has gone through a brainwashing system where he's taught not to critically think, but he's taught, and she, what to think and not how to think. They will have new voters. And in one moment, in 2018, the politicians said, after an enormous pressure by the civil society, by young people, by grassroots activists, by international community, very important to say, by the OECE, who really had an enormous pressure on the ground, on politicians, we have succeeded. We have succeeded in overcoming an attempt of local politician and cantonal politician to segregate a school. And this is not just important for this example in Jajce. This sends a strong message to all other nationalist politicians throughout the country that attempting to segregate the next school will meet with fierce resistance. And currently in Bosnia and Herzegovina, there are 56 segregated schools. And I wouldn't say that, you know, Bosnian politicians are okay with the status quo. They're not. They even want to deepen the divisions, deepen the hate, especially between the young people who are future pillars of Bosnian society. And then in 2018, the OECE and the Dutch Ministry for Foreign Affairs, they awarded the students, activists, and small number of teachers with the Max van der Stoel Award. It's a biannual award given to groups who fight for human rights. And very important to say, I'm very disappointed that teachers were not on the side of students, that parents, generally speaking, were not on the side of students, because we do have a situation where we were expecting them to be with their children and with their students. However, all of them and majority of them, in case of local communities, have gotten their jobs thanks to these nationalistic parties, you know? And the biggest obstacles for students were not teachers, were not politicians, you know, it was not Bosnian society, it was parents, you know, within their four walls. In the moment where they toppled, you know, this resistance coming from parents within their four walls, then the students could, you know, really unleash their civic society potential that we really see on the ground that has power, and that this example of Jajce students, of minors, has shown that young people can achieve a potent direct impact on political decisions. And I think this is a beautiful, beautiful message for all of those young people currently in Bosnia and Herzegovina fighting their own battles. I want to tell them that we do see them, we do hear them. We need to keep being persistent, strong, and we need to connect, build alliances, and hopefully we will do achieve similar successes as achieved by the students from Jajce.
Thank you, Samir, for this really inspiring, not only story, but for the experience and for the results you have managed to achieve. I remember when that was happening and I was following it in the media. It's really a very promising thing you have done and really laying down a lot of hopes. Talking about school segregations, divisions, that leads you to our next speaker, Lucija Babić from Mostar. We had the pleasure to already meet Lucija in the documentary we just saw before our panel. Lucija was born in 2002, so Dayton was already old when she was born. And she lives in Mostar, whom most of us somehow connect with the term of a divided city. But she overcomes these divisions with art, by theater, dancing, and music. So welcome, Lucija. And please tell us a bit, how do you see Mostar? And is it really that divided as we from not only from abroad, but from outside maybe think it is?
First of all, thank you, Aleksandra, for this wonderful introduction. In terms of divided Mostar, I would like to say that division is present, as it is everywhere. It is also present in education. And I can say that I am honored to say that I was a student of the Gymnasium Mostar, which is the first school in Mostar that had both Bosnian and Croatian education plan in one building. With now being a United World College student in Mostar, I am also experiencing the IB curriculum that is placed in the same building with the two local curriculums. With three different schools under one roof, I would say that it also symbolizes this coming of together and hope for the youth that we can overcome this division that is presented to us by our parents and grandparents and by the past of this country, And with that symbolism, we can look forward to our future and get together. As you've said, I do think that art is a big connecting point, because I myself channel all of these things that are put onto us as young people of this country through art, whether it be theater art or music, visual art. Art in general is a vent that young people use in order to continue their everyday lives and feel well welcomed in this society. As a part of a divided city called Mostar, well, a lot of people like to put emphasis on its division, whereas I, as a generation of post-conflict young people, don't really see it that way. In my eyes, Mostar is divided. Sadly, that is true, and division is very present. But amongst my peers, it is something that we try to overcome every day. And I've seen this as this opportunity of education in Gymnasia and in UWC as an opportunity to help me understand different people and understand my situation in this country as well, in order to overcome this division and also encourage my peers to overcome it as well.
Thank you very much. I was a bit lost now due to internet connection reasons, but I heard, unfortunately, just the last part of your words. We will, at a later point, get back to you again, because, of course, everybody's curious about the upcoming elections, so we will speak about it in a second round. And last but not least, let us welcome today Jasminko Halilović, who is the founder and director of the War Childhood Museum, the only museum worldwide exclusively focused on the experience of childhood affected by war, a museum awarded by the Council of Europe Museum Prize. He's the author of the award-winning book War Childhood, and also the first Bosnian to be selected for the prestigious Forbes 30 Under 30 list. So, Jasminko, let's start with the founding of the museum. Where did the idea came from? How did you begin, and where are you now?
Hi, everyone. And first of all, let me thank you for putting together this event and for having me today, and also having such a great group of panelists to discuss some things that are part of what we do and a big chunk of what we think about when we think about future of this country. So, as you said, I founded the War Childhood Museum. This is the project which started for me in 2010, so 10 years now, started as a book project where I collected experiences, memories of people whose childhoods were affected by war in Bosnia in the 1990s. Hundreds of people responded to my invitation, which I published online as a public call to share some of their memories. And in the end, more than 1,000 people participated in this book project. The book was published in 2013 and later translated to several languages. One of the things which I learned while working on the book was that people have a tendency to connect their memories to certain physical objects, personal belongings. Another thing which I learned is also that they have a need to speak about this. Many of these people would say it's been 15, 20 years since the war ended, and never anyone asked me how it was for me as a child. So no one asked me about my experience. So after hearing all of this and learning that people didn't have enough platforms to speak about their experiences, people of my generation who were children during the war, I decided that book might not be enough, because many people did not see this call or did not participate. So I started thinking what would be a more sustainable way to document and present this experience and educate about it. I understood while reading these memories, I understood how complex this experience it is, how different it can be even for a brother and sister living in the same home. And also what was very important for me, I learned how inspiring these stories can be and how they can inspire hope. And that's why I decided to create a museum which will continuously document and present these stories. So that's how the idea for the War Childhood Museum was born. And after the book was published and it was well received by the whole generation as an ultimate testament to our generation experience. And this encouraged me to continue to the next stage and to create the War Childhood Museum. So together with a team of young experts and scientists from different fields, anthropology, psychology, history, we developed methodology and started creating the collection for the Future Museum in 2014. In 2016, we had first temporary exhibitions. In 2017, we opened the permanent museum in Sarajevo, Bosnia and Herzegovina. Soon after opening the museum, we also started working internationally. Today, we have projects in different countries. We have our first international office opened this year in Kiev, Ukraine. And now I'm speaking from Venice, Italy, where we are working on a new exhibition. The War Childhood Museum grew into an institution which is one of the rare safe places for people to speak about war memories and war experiences. It grew into an institution which challenges the usual perception of children as only passive victims of conflicts, but promotes highlights their resilience, their creativity, their ability to influence not only their lives, but also lives of people around them. And this makes the War Childhood Museum, its approach, its inclusive approach, its determination to tell these stories with dignity and integrity, its determination to be open for anyone who shares this experience, it makes it a bit different from what we are used to when we are speaking to war in Bosnia, and it makes it a bad fit for agendas of major political parties and forces in the country. And that's why it also makes it a target. And as we could hear from Samir to some extent, and also I know that Ivana was lately also targeted in media, there is a huge pressure on in general, on activists, on people working in a sector, trying to promote different approaches. There is a pressure through media, there is a pressure through lack of opportunities, lack of funding. So different tools are used to prevent this kind of alternative approaches and new different approaches. But I firmly believe that the War Childhood Museum is one of the examples of potential of what grassroots initiative can do, because the War Childhood Museum was started by a group of young people without even without donors at that time, started by a group of volunteers and grew up into an institution that worked with more than 5,000 children from all over the country every year. In this way, we try to give our contribution.
Thank you very much. A very inspiring story. And you do so much more than it would be in the description of a museum. So there is so much more what you have picked up on and what you actually deliver with the museum. And again, filling a gap that one might expect that that is the role of institutions to do so. Everything what we have heard today leads us to the conclusion that personal engagement and this enthusiasm and that activism can make a difference. And as Ivana assessed, that it was almost like in post-war Bosnia, never worse than before when we look at certain indicators and state capture and corruption. And also picking up on a question that Jasmina Husanović has posed in the chat, what's the reason, and the question was explicitly to you, Jasmin, but you are also on my list now. What do you think is the reason we don't see more citizens' engagement if we see that it's actually working, and how much is left from 2014? And here I'm adding to Jasmina's question. She's asking because a lot of people out of that uprising actually have left the country.
So I think in some ways I reject the premise of the question, and I think it's a very good question. I think it's a hugely important question, but I kind of reject the premise of it, which is to say, you know, I'm on a panel right now with four other absolutely incredible individuals, right? I mean, I don't think people appreciate what it takes to come from Bosnia, a very small country, a very poor country, a very riven and divided society. And then for that country to produce people like Samir or Jasminko or Ivana or Lucija. I mean, there's not a lot of us, right? There is not a lot of us. And then look at the kinds of caliber of individuals that we have produced. And of course, then I could run through the list of people in the diaspora, our writers, our artists, our athletes, our scientists. You know, this is the thing. I mean, for instance, something like what Samir has done or Jasmin has done very concretely, or the everyday work that Ivana does, or even the kind of student-based engagement that Lucija is doing, you run every day into an entire architecture and artifice every single day that is trying to break you down, that is trying to intimidate you, that is trying to take things away from you, take away your relationships, take away your home, your security, your safety. Right. So I think in some ways we have to also be realistic about the kinds of stakes and costs that are associated with being an activist in Bosnia and Herzegovina. It's comparatively very easy for somebody like me who doesn't spend most of my day-to-day life in Bosnia. And even when I do, I run into these experiences. But because I have the privilege of being, living in the United States presently, and I'm you know, of that diaspora generation that left during the early parts of the war, I have all kinds of access, privilege, and power that a lot of my colleagues in Bosnia don't have, right? And then when we go back to 2014, the very specific experiences of those protests and subsequent protests, because protests have continued in Bosnia, you know, they didn't make the front page of the New York Times, but they have continued. Ivana mentioned the Pravda za Davida or Pravda za Jenina. I mean, the people are confronted with police intimidation, police violence, the entire architecture of a deeply corrupted and deeply cynical both law enforcement community and, of course, something that we heard a lot about, the judiciary, right? When you have people like Milan Tegeltija being one of the highest judicial authorities, legal authorities in the country, it gives you a sense of the kinds of barriers that people like Samir, Ivana and Lucija, Jasminko face every single day, and all of us that are trying to create a better, more representative, democratic, engaged, participatory Bosnia and Herzegovina. So finally, just to say, I mean, of course, all of us want to see more sustained engagement. But I think one of the really important things that Jasminko is doing in particular, and I would urge everyone to really support the War Childhood Museum as much as they can. You know, if you've thought about donating to Sarajevo Calling, don't donate to his museum, much more important. They are creating safe spaces. They are creating learning spaces for our generation and still younger kids to encounter each other, to learn from each other. And that, again, is so important about the work that Simon and Lucija are doing. You know, those young generations encountering each other and being like, look, we're probably not going to agree on everything. We have all kinds of baggage and trauma from our parents and our grandparents. But let's just talk because you seem okay, and I think we have similar problems. Maybe we can get the ball going.
Thank you. Thank you very much. No, of course, there are positive examples and smaller ones. And as you say, they don't make it to the front pages, but they are there. And you mentioned Pravda za Davida. Ivana already mentioned it as well. I would like Ivana to ask you to bring us that movement a bit closer. The sad context and the whole tragedy behind it. You are from Banja Luka. You have both perspectives as something that happened in your city, but also as Transparency International has supported institutionally.
Yes, I mean, this has been a reaction actually of everything that has been going on with the judiciary for the past years. So it was an example, a case of a young man who was murdered, whose murder was first identified as an accident by the police and by the institutions. case, to publish relevant information to the citizens, and the attempt of cover-up, basically, of the whole case, which enraged the not only the people who were close to the young man, David, but also the whole city, and which led to a series of protests every day in Banja Luka. This caused very repressive measures by the police in Republika Srpska, and even some of the attempts of changing the legal framework in order to give more authority to police when it comes to dealing with citizens and the arrest without any kind of proper cause or similar issues. The protest lasted for months. At the end led to police brutality against not only the members of the group of Pravda za Davida, but also other citizens of Banja Luka who were just there protesting, which actually was counterproductive because it enraged people even more and brought even more people to the streets. But I have to say, it's been 1,000 days since this happened. I think today I saw somewhere that it's been 1,000 days. And people are, of course, running out of energy to talk about this, to be in the street every day. There is still, the group is now has its own organization that is registered as a citizens organization, who are trying to continue putting pressure on the institutions on and fighting for justice at the end. But as I said, I think that it got a lot more political than it should have, in terms of people had more expectations, even though the protest began as a reaction to one case, a murder, and the reaction of judiciary. At the end, people basically thought that it will bring change in the elections, that it will have more political impact on in Republika Srpska, but also in the whole country. And it didn't. Unfortunately, it didn't even have an impact on the institutions who are supposed to prosecute this case of murder. We still don't know who murdered this young boy. Nobody has been convicted yet. And we now, unfortunately, see even worse and worse situation within judiciary and corruption within judiciary, which is scandalous, which has never been so open. And there has never been less accountability within the judicial system. But of course, we have to realize that this was, an example of how people can unite around an issue which is not so political. And it is much easier, I think, to unite people around an issue which does not, target some kind of long-term institutional reform, but a very simple situation. We want to know who killed this young man, and we want accountability in this case. And this is maybe a lesson for the future when it comes to any kind of protests or citizens' engagement. That when we talk, for example, about corruption, it would be harder to unite so many people just around the general issue of corruption. It would also be harder because a lot of people are actually engaging in corruption every day. They are actually admitting or realizing that this situation is unavoidable, that at least in their perception, and that everyone is basically opportunistic, and if they have something to out of the system, they will participate. And we see this in the election every 2 years. You know, people participate in this, you know, through short-term gain, not realizing that how the long-term effects that this type of behavior has. So it would be very hard to unite all these people, for example, against corruption in general, because everyone has some kind of interest. But if it is a very concrete case of something that might not be so political, but is can be understood on a personal level by every individual in the country, then it is much easier to unite the people. And of course, it brought, at the end, it showed all the brutality of the system here in Republika Srpska. Unfortunately, it became more authoritarian, more repressive as a response to the protest and to the group. And we saw, as I said, you know, crazy cases of persecution of any kind of activists, not just members of the group, Pravda for Zadavida, but also others. And any kind of criticism is attacked by the government. We saw some changes now in Banja Luka with the new mayor being elected, but we still haven't seen a change, general change towards human rights issues. The new mayor says that he will allow for Pravda za the group to be, you know, to protest and to gather on the square, but he says also that he doesn't want a pride parade or to admit the rights of LGBT community. So this is again hypocrisy, because we will selectively look at the human rights and justice in general.
Yeah, we will decide who has the right to gather and the right to assembly and not grant it as a basic human or civic right. You mentioned running out of energy and actually coming together around something very concrete, as is this example about basic human security and response of the system. Do you feel protected and secure or you don't? So I would like just to read out a comment of Andre de Munter here in this, that EU officials should not go and meet politicians, but rather students, activists, and like this also make their cause more visible. Samir, I think that your role here in this panel is to provide us with good news and with positive examples, because you do have to share another one with us, one that is very important currently in Bosnia, but also throughout the whole region, and that is the protection of rivers and the fight against small hydropower plants that are threatening to take away the rest, what is left, and that's at least the beautiful nature we can find around. So, could you please tell us a little bit more about that fight and especially about the good results? We need some good news today.
Okay, so I didn't know I'm the one who should be providing with good news, so no pressure for me. But in any case, yes, as you have said, now there is, well, first of all, before I start, I would absolutely agree with Mr. De Munter, who said that politicians should be talking to civil society, young people, students, pupils, even minors. As we have seen, they do have an enormous power only if we give them a platform and give them if we trust them. This is, I think, the word that we have been missing. And then we will get hope as a product. Now in the small hero power plant problem has been fallen on our shoulders, not just in Bosnia and Herzegovina, but also in the Western Balkans throughout past decade maybe. And just a couple of weeks ago, a couple of days ago, we had another shady investor coming to my hometown. Can you imagine? And for those who do not know, Jajce is a beautiful city. I'm not now here advertising anything, so I'm not paid by the tourist agency of Jajce. But Jajce is a beautiful city with the waterfall, with its waterfall, world famous waterfall in the center of the city. It's one of the 12 most beautiful waterfalls in the world, according to Lonely Planet, and the only waterfall in the world situated in the city center. And these shady investors have planned to build two small power plants 300 meters away from the waterfall. Now try to imagine that. So what we had again was, it was again a really quick reaction, a fast reaction, a strategic reaction of civil society in Jajce. On the 29th of November, on the anniversary of Avnoj, when Yugoslavia was established again in Jajce, we sat down at the table and we said, okay, how are we going to unite and how are we going to work in order to chase them away? Because It was clear, as you know, it was like really, really clear that these guys didn't come here to offer anything for the local community, just like any of the investors or, you know, owners of other 109 power plants, small power plants currently existing and working in Jajce. So what we did is that we ran a really extensive campaign, local campaign, asking for people to collect signatures, you know, reaching out to NGOs, reaching out to local politicians, lobbying religious leaders. And it was really, really amazing. The energy and the solidarity around like these environmental issues is even greater than the solidarity that we had around, you know, segregated schools. Because segregated schools, that's a, you know, polarizing issue, you know. But when it comes to nature, to preserving natural habitat, to preserving water that we drink, is something that everyone was, you know, behind us. And in the end, we have managed we had in the end more petition signatures that the mayor than the votes that the mayor of Jajce has gotten in the local elections. We had 50 NGOs local. I didn't even know that Jajce has 50 NGOs, but we had like their heads of NGOs signing the papers, you know, saying, okay, we are behind you. And this is, you know, this is a big voter material in terms of, you know, when we reach out to politicians. And then in the end, we also reached, you know, to politicians, and the vast majority of local politicians put their signature on the petition saying, now, okay, if the investors come, we will reject their offer. And they made these statements publicly. And even the Franciscan community and the Islamic community in Jajce were also unified together against these shady investors who would just, I will just like tell you this, they would get as a profit, they would get around 130,000 euros, and they would bring back to the budget around 12,000 euros back, which is like, you know, it's like 10 times more. It's pure profit. And they would devastate small Pliva River, big Pliva River, big Pliva Lake, waterfall. And absolutely what we said, you know, we are Pliva. We are water. Two-thirds of our bodies is water. And in case of people in Jajce, it is Pliva. We drink Pliva, and people said, we do not want you here. And in the end, like very successful, and I would say, even though it's not yet end, like last week, the investors said, okay, we will back off. They retreated their proposal, you know, to build it. However, they said, we will come back in the moment when, you know, the municipal council convenes. However, in this case, we have, you know, bring out, you know, municipal councillors, and their votes are here on our side. So we really do hope that they will also reject this shady proposal. But this is not just problem of Jajce, and I will finish with that. Currently, as I said, 109 small power plants are built. And within the next couple of years, there are plans that more than 300 power plants should start operating in Bosnia on 224 rivers. And I think this is something where local activists, environmental activists will need an enormous, sincere support of international community. And I do invite foreign ambassadors. I do invite heads of international organizations. I really have to give a shout out to OECE. Just before meeting you here at this panel, I had like a long meeting from team from the OECE came to Jajce just to check how we can support you. And I think this is a good way forward. This is a good way forward both for the internationals here working on the ground in Bosnia, but also a very good sign. Very good sign for our local activists to reach out to international community and to seek for allyship from them. And I do hope by the January 2021, we will have a law that will forbid all small power plants to be built, because they do not bring anything to the local community, but only to the investors. So I will stop here. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And this is really encouraging that despite the tiredness and the fatigue that, or the depression that has, that the pandemic has added, you are still there. You have concrete results. You're fighting for the visibility needed. And as you said, it's a shouting out, but it's almost like really an outcry and a scream, because we all together cannot allow this to happen. And I think it's interesting symbolism that you are overcoming divisions and having this kind of partisan fight in Jajce. So thank you very much for that. I would like to come to Jasminko once again. Could you maybe tell us a bit how your work is perceived in Bosnia? It seems to me that you are also like a fighter outside the institutions, or as our panel says, despite institutions, that your results are based despite them not recognizing or supporting the aim of your work. And how is that in comparison when you have international starings or travels with the exhibition? Could you make a comparison there on what's missing in Bosnia from that side?
Yes, thank you. First, I would like just to briefly say that I'm really inspired by what we heard from Samir, and I want to add on what Jasmin said. Reconsider Jasmin's idea to donate to the World Childhood Museum. Maybe it's more important to support the work to protect our rivers, and that's something we all hear about, of course. Yes, so, but thank you, Jasmin. Jasmin is one of the donors of the World Childhood Museum himself. So it's nice to see him advocating for a museum like this. Yes, so I mean, as we can hear from these examples and stories, I do feel and I believe that change is possible, and I do firmly believe that the War Childhood Museum is one of these initiatives that contributes to a positive change in our society in Bosnia. When you ask me to compare how it is to work in Bosnia and how it is to work in other countries, of course, when we are living in a post-conflict society that has so many issues, we heard about some of them today. It always seems like it's easier to work anywhere else. But as we go somewhere else and start working there, as the War Childhood Museum opened its office in Ukraine, I mentioned we work in this country, we also have our projects in other countries. In every context, there are some issues. Of course, there are some basic things that people in other countries and in developed countries, they take it for granted. And that is, if you do a quality work, if you do internationally recognized work, as we do at the War Childhood Museum, you will not at least face obstructions on a very local level from politicians. You would more likely face some support, or at least you would be ignored but not obstructed. And this is one of the differences we see in Bosnia. And also something that was mentioned, it's really frustrating to see international politicians coming to Bosnia, posing with these people that destroyed our country after it was destroyed in the war, destroyed it once again, destroyed opportunity for young people to have a bright future in our country, so they leave in so big numbers. And then they come, they shake hands with them, make photos with them, and I would even argue support them publicly. And they know what they do. And this is something that's really frustrating. And being exposed to so many young people all around Bosnia, of course, it will take time for real change to happen. And this is clear to everyone. But there are so many positive examples, like what we heard from Lucija. And there are so many signs of hope. And if we keep working together, even though it is more difficult to work in our own country than to work internationally, and even to export our work internationally, because we as a museum, we are currently invited in at least 10 countries to come with our exhibitions. In our own country, it's sometimes difficult to go to some cities to do the exhibition. It's impossible for us to work with schools in some parts of the countries because ministries of education don't allow us to do it. And even when I met one of these ministers, he told me during the meeting, "I see what you do is positive. It's not against anyone, but if I would allow you to work in schools in my city, I would hang on the main square tomorrow." So this approach, where the things are not judged, it's not merit-based, it's not content-based, it's just politicized to an extent that it's really becoming hard to process and endure. This is what really makes it difficult to work. But again, all of these examples of organizations, activists, and initiatives, and all the voices like Jasmin's who are amplifying our voices internationally, I do believe that if we work together, we will prevail, because this is a long run thing. And before, as I was younger, I was so frustrated about all of these things. But then I understood politics change. They will be there and leave, and we will remain. And if we build sustainable initiatives, sustainable organizations, and if we keep doing our work, we will prevail.
Thank you very much. Too bad that we still have half an hour. This would be really nice closing words. I really think that like here at this panel, we have seen this wonderful solidarity. Like Jasmin said, if you want to, if you plan to support my cause, please don't do support the War Childhood Museum. And then the War Childhood Museum, Jasminko says, if you plan to support us, please don't do support Samir. So this is so great, and this gives back so much hope we all need, especially in these times now. I would like to ask you, Lucija. Jasminko was saying that he's remaining and fighting, and that he has this belief that change is possible, and that long-lasting change is possible to achieve. You said in the documentary that even if you go abroad for studies, that you would like to come back. Do you think that these examples we heard today, and also these examples you mentioned from Mostar, are the basis for your wish and to your belief that changes are possible, and that the future in Bosnia is possible? And just to add one additional question, Mostar is facing the first election for the city council in 12 years. Do you think elections are an instrument for change? And how do you face your first elections? I mean, your first elections, normally that sounds always so special, but in the case of Mostar, everybody who is 30 will have their first elections of this kind now. So could you maybe elaborate on these two things of leaving, staying, and on the question of elections, please?
Yes, so I think that any kind of change is positive change towards the development and providing opportunities for the youth to actually succeed in this country and stay. And that is why I like the fact that my school, the UWC, fully supports me in my decision to leave and supports me in upgrading my education somewhere else, so that I could one day come back and use that knowledge in order to improve this region or this country, or make even a slight change in my city or a certain community. In terms of elections, I feel as if they are obviously a big part of today in Mostar. After a long time of not having them, they are a current hot topic, I would say. And of course, it is good that elections are here, because this is the opportunity for the people to elect their representatives, to make a change even in the slightest way, so that the society can move on and start improving. This is kind of the base of where it should start from. It should start politically from these elections. These are my first elections that I'm attending, and I will attend them because this is my democratic duty, and I feel as if I should be an example to my other peers that would see me. Hopefully, if they do see this, they would be encouraged to also go out and vote and start being more politically engaged.
Yes, that's a very great appeal. Like, do go out and vote, make right of your citizens' democratic right, as you said. And do please connect to Sami, because he is a board member of the Western Balkans Alumni Association, taking care of people that actually want to come back. So don't lose that connection, and let's not lose Lucija. We have a question from the audience. Kurt Basunet asks, And I would like to pass this question especially to Jasminko and to Samir, because he asks, what could the democratic international community do to enable your work and your bottom-up and concrete work on the ground? And the other part of the question is, what should they be stopping doing? So who wants first, Samir or Jasminko?
I'm not sure if I heard the first part, which organization is referred to, or like, is it general, like international community?
No, in general, what should the international community do? What are the means they could support the visibility, not only the visibility, but also the impact and results of your actions and activities on the ground?
Well, absolutely. Maybe I can say a sentence or two, and then Jasmin can take over. I would say what we do need to see from the international community, from the internationals here, is like it. I would say it's two things. First thing is that we local activists on the ground, internationals should talk first of all to the local activists on the ground. In my experience, this is usually not happening. It is either we as activists having really hard time reach the big names that we usually see on the TV, you know, foreign ambassadors, heads of, you know, I'm not saying that we should talk every time to heads of international organizations, but even when we were fighting, you know, against segregation, we needed 6 months to bring internationals on our playing field, you know, and usually they are, and I really do have a problem with that when they say, you know, okay, look, we cannot really say that we are on your side, on the side of activists. We will try to be neutral. Well, guess what? In a lot of cases, you cannot be neutral, because being neutral in the times of moral crisis means standing on the side of the oppressor. And these are not, I think, my words. This is Dante Alighieri, if I'm not wrong. And internationals need really to take sides, because when it comes to segregation, when it comes to devastation of nature, there is no neutral side. Those who are neutral are on the side of those who want to divide young people, who want to plunder our goods, who want to, you know, impoverish Bosnia and Herzegovina. And this is really something that internationals should, first of all, go to young people, talk to the activists, one thing, and second, very, very important, say it out publicly. You know, go to the media, shake hands with them publicly in front of TV camera, because this kind of it's also symbolic message to the public saying, hey, look, we are with you. We are with young people of Bosnia and Herzegovina. And that's also a signal to politicians saying, you know, okay, like we know who respects and who fights for big, real values that we also cherish. So I would say, like, from speaking and talking, I would really like them to move to working together, not with those who have been, you know, dividing us for the last 25 years, and who have been a reason and cause for young people, my generation, to leave. But they should start working with those young people who want and plan to stay in Bosnia and Herzegovina and to build it in a way that they want to see it in the upcoming decade or two.
Why do you think this is not happening already? Do you think that international decision makers and politicians see you also as troublemakers the same way local politicians do?
I don't think they see us as troublemakers. That would be a bit weird that activists are troublemakers. I think that they want to talk to those people who were elected by people, you know. However, we need to take in consideration that around 50% of Bosnian population votes, around 50% of young people vote. In Bosnia and Herzegovina, we do have around 610,000 of young people who could vote. Only half of them votes, which is also an EU average. Now, the question is why the rest of the young people and of the general population vote. This year, I was the observer with the Podlupom coalition. And I have been talking to young people, you know, a lot of young people do not feel and do not trust the election process. You know, instead of trying to name and shame young people for not voting, well, first of all, I would like to invite international community to try to work with politicians and with activists in trying to bring, you know, electoral process to become more transparent, you know, to try to, you know, work within the system in bringing more trust towards young people when it comes to election process. And maybe then young people will not just vote, but they will also, you know, candidate, they will run for elections. And very, very important thing, which I also noticed that internationals and even, you know, some kind of sometimes academics think sometimes that young people being, you know, running for elections, running for office, that will bring a change. I do not think so. I don't think that young people will bring a change. I think that young and old, democratically oriented, liberal, progressive politicians will bring change. Last local elections, like just past local elections, we have seen that some young mayors, young politicians have become mayors. Well, I don't think that them being elected will bring change to Banja Luka, let's say. I do think that young people who ride the same nationalistic rhetoric will not bring a change. They will just reinforce the status quo, and they will just reinforce what we have been having in the last 25 years. So working with young, progressively oriented, democratic young people who work on the ground and show that publicly will be something that young people and activists in general in Bosnia and Herzegovina will appreciate a lot from the international organizations. And I think I spoke too much. Sorry.
No, you spoke great. Every word was worth the second. So thank you very much. Yes, I absolutely agree. We have to group around values and attitudes and not around age. And what you said sounds just so logic and self-explanatory, but still it's not happening, I think. And I think that's the main point of why it's not happening, if it's just self-explaining. Jasminko, same question to you, and also in adding that you actually had a visit by High Representative Borrell to your museum. So could you tell us if that has changed something for your visibility and the visibility of your work?
Obviously I agree with Samir on most of things, but here I just want to add a bit different perspective. Some positive thing. The War Childhood Museum, really, since the very beginning, when we didn't have any structure, infrastructure, anything, we really enjoyed a lot of support from the international community, both those present in Bosnia and those outside of Bosnia. And this is in some stages of the museum development, this was one of the key sources of support for us. They brought in some funding, they facilitated meetings with local politicians, they put some pressure on local politicians, they gave the visibility to the museum. So I want to be honest and to highlight this positive role international community had in the development of the War Childhood Museum and continues to have. And especially if you are speaking about international community present in Bosnia and Herzegovina, some very active ambassadors, not to name them now, some very active embassies, proactive embassies that are supporting continuously our work, the work of the War Childhood Museum, maybe not so much financially anymore, but in different ways. So this is just what I wanted to add. And another thing was what was mentioned is, but I do agree with Samir that maybe sometimes some organizations, maybe even the War Childhood Museums, receives too much of a visibility, and that this visibility should be better spread around the country. The visibility the international community can provide should be better spread around the country and better balanced to include also some individual initiatives or initiatives of informal groups. The second thing was about the visit of High Representative Borrell to the War Childhood Museum. The War Childhood Museum hosts many of these high-level visits, and it's always good to be this place from where important messages will be sent. There are some values the War Childhood Museum stands for, and these values are luckily shared by most of the international community, including the European Union, and some of messages supporting these values were sent from our museum. I don't want to speak too much, but it was already mentioned, sometimes just sending messages will not help too much. It is important, but I think action, joint action and joint effort is needed more. I was crossing EU border today. I was once again afraid, like in the visa time, I was afraid because now in COVID time, again, I don't know if I'll be able to get in the EU, if I'll not be able, do I have all the documentation, this sense of Bosnia continuously being pushed outside of Europe, not being considered as a part of Europe. And we Bosnians, we believe that we are heart of Europe. So it's opposite feeling completely. And we don't want to leave our country in order to live in Europe. And this is what's happening now. Young Bosnians are leaving their own country to live in Europe, and Bosnia is in Europe. And I really hope, I know it's not realistic to hope, but I will forever hope that the EU will help Bosnia a bit more to get into the Union.
Thank you. Well, luckily you're young enough, so there is a lot of time left to be hoping for. I was just told that we have to close earlier because of the follow-up interviews. There are many unanswered questions in the chat. Some went into the direction of the education system and how to overcome the segregations. Others are really just praising all of you, and I will just join into that praise. I think this was really a fantastic panel, very encouraging, with a lot of different perspectives, but really so real life perspectives. We haven't touched EU integration, we haven't touched migration. There are so many things we haven't touched. I can just tell that I'm really sorry that this is happening online, because continuing with you now after the panel over coffee is something that is just the heart of any conference after the official program. And I really hope that Majda will bring us together in this form together next year when we are all vaccinated. Thank you very much, everybody. Stay safe, stay healthy, stay sane. And back to you, Anna.
Thank you very much, Aleksandra, and thank you for our panel for the refreshing insights on how future Bosnian generations are creating their own change. And personally, I'm really glad to see their energy, because maybe that means that apathy isn't winning after all. We'll have a short break now until 4:40 p.m. Berlin time, at which time we will have a pre-recorded interview between Majda Ruge and Christian Amanpour, whom you may have heard of, as CNN's chief international anchor. They will take the conversation back in time a little bit from this one, and they'll talk about Christian Amanpour's reflections on Bosnia 25 years ago and where she thinks that the country is headed from today on. We look forward to seeing you at 4:40 p.m. Thank you.